Okay.
Hi, Barbie.
Hi, now you can see and hear me. I had to click a button that is not at all visible. So I'm on with StreamYard help right now. That seems to have done it. So we apologize. Hopefully people can see us. Although typically at this point I would see how many people are here. And I don't see that. All right. Well, Case, you know my technical challenges, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, I know. So, you know, we are adapting, we are agile, we are living our five imperatives, right? So this is a great test for me. So thank you, everybody who may be watching. Hopefully, I haven't had everybody run away from us.
Yeah, it's interesting because I can, you're definitely on. I can see you talking on LinkedIn. You just can't see our faces. So that's fun.
So I don't know how to undo that.
Can you like remove the background?
Right. Well, it says it's an overlay. So you would think that it would overlay. Right. So, okay.
I see you now.
Okay, right. Okay. But that's interesting because that's overlaying the StreamYard one versus the one I made. But hey, you can see me. That's awesome. Okay. Next to the timer. Yep, I see that. Okay. Well, no idea right now.
Now people can see your face though, so that's fine.
Well, that's good. That's good. Although they probably already clicked off because we weren't there. So, what we can do, however, is we can have our conversation and then post it for people to watch later. How's that?
It looks like there's a few people on, so I think we're good either way.
Okay. Normally there's a number that I can see on the screen and I don't see that number. So we're going to get started and we're going to figure this out for next time. So thank you everyone for being patient. I'm not really sure why the overlay of the StreamYard works, but the overlay I created doesn't. But StreamYard is technology that integrates with LinkedIn to facilitate the LinkedIn live sessions. So there's lots of branding on the screen for StreamYard right now. Yay them. So hopefully we'll figure out what we need to do for next time. So thank you everyone for joining me. And I have a very special guest and friend today, Casey Walter. Casey, can we see you? Let me try this other thing. There we are. All right. So Casey was gracious enough to agree to join me today because I am kicking off a series of conversations, roundtable conversations with thought leaders, experts, and folks who I have either worked with or know of in different areas to talk about not only their experience within the human resources or people function, but what is it like when you're outside of HR or the people function? And what is that experience like? How does that change your perception of the work we do within HR? What do you see as the gaps and the strengths that exist today? And what are some of the things that you think folks working within the people space can do to really level up and improve their career, improve the perception of HR within our businesses, and really help to make that transformative change to be the people leaders we need for the workforce, not only of today, but the workforce of the future? We've been through so much over the past year or so that I think so many things about the way we work has changed. And as the HR support or the support for people, we have to adapt to that change. So Casey, if you'd like to share with us a little bit about who you are, your story, and where you are and where you're going, because you have some exciting news there too. I will pass it over to you for a moment.
Sure. Yeah. So hi, everyone. For those of you that are have stayed on and are listening still, I'm Casey Walter. I've been in HR for, oh boy, I don't even want to say how long. I know, Barbie, it's longer for you, but still, I'm getting up there in my numbers. But recently, in the past couple of years, I've actually transitioned out of HR for a little bit to really focus on strategy, overall strategy for the company, and really focusing that direction. So it's definitely been interesting. I'm looking forward to telling you all my interesting tidbits that I've learned along the way of not being in HR. But it's actually, over the past few years, really refocused me. And now I feel like I have such a better toolkit to come back into HR and be better and be that better partner for everyone. So I think the knowledge I've gained has been amazing outside of HR, but now actually I'm moving into a new role that's actually going to be part of HR. So very excited for that. Very excited to get back into the HR side of it, the people experience side of it.
Yeah. So let's talk about your journey a little bit. So you started off in HR in more of a generalist space. And then you moved into talent acquisition and went pretty deep there, especially when we think about high volume recruiting. And, you know, you and I and our teams have hired, you know, tens of thousands of people over the past several years for some pretty large and well-known brands. And then about 2 years ago, a year and a half, 2 years ago, you made a decision to really get into project management and take your skills up a bit there. So talk us through kind of what made you decide to gain that certification and go into that space. What were you seeing or not seeing within the HR space that had you want to move into PMO type work?
Yeah, and I feel like there with the PMO work, there's a lot of structure around it, and specifically the change management side. A lot of people where the HR and the PMO side kind of come together is that change management function, because it impacts so many people, regardless of if it's a technology implementation or something that you don't think is going to impact your people. At the end of the day, it's change. And change is going to impact your people regardless. And I think that's something that gets missed quite frequently. That's definitely a big gap, even in the HR space sometimes. We think so much about the people that we forget about how change impacts them sometimes too. So it's always something that needs to be at the top of your mind, something to reflect on. But that's really what initially made me move into that PMO type of space and to really help with that change management, looking at it from a people side of things and really helping and educating the leadership on how to truly make those changes happen without impacting your employees like that.
Yeah, for sure. And something you said, right, is change management. And we've had conversations and I've spoken many times about change management and change leadership. And I think that's kind of the sweet spot, right, is when you're able to combine those two elements of change management, which is the structural side of change, right? The tactical elements of we have to do this before we do this, before we do this, and you're putting all of that in place. But you alluded to the change leadership side. And so I'd really like to get into a bit of conversation around that and then how you, because you've successfully been able to bring those two things together. And traditionally we've seen one or the other. And I think what we have learned over the past year for sure, but I'd say, you know, a couple of years, is that we really do need the combination of both, but we need our leadership teams to understand that they are distinct and different, but they can work in concert. So when you think about the PMO and the structure of it, right, there's Kotter's change management, which is probably one of the most well-known change management theories. And there's eight steps, right? And you go through the eight steps. What if the change leadership piece, like how do you explain that to people? And how have you been able to bring the change leadership to meet the change management so that you can get that transformation?
Yeah, the easiest way I describe the change leadership side of it, and I do bucket it for ease when I talk about change management, which you know. So I think it's for me, it's a holistic bucket. But the way I like to describe it to people, I do describe the change management side of it as the structure and the governance and what that looks like. But the easiest way to describe the change leadership side of it is the people experience and also the emotional side of change management. That's how I like to like differentiate it, is change management's the structure of it, but then change leadership is the emotions that drive around change and how you're bringing an empathy into conversations, having the transparency around it. So those common themes and then where those come up and come into play along your change journey too.
Absolutely. And I think when we think about the communication piece, communication exists in change management, but it traditionally says we communicate when we're doing this. So we're rolling out this phase on this date. We're rolling out this phase on this date. And traditionally, that's what change management communication is focused on, is simply informing people of the what is happening. And I think where change leadership and communication come together is we also explain the why behind it, how we're making the change, and how it's going to impact them as an individual, right? Because one of the things we've studied and we've talked about is how change leadership really does follow, in many ways, the stages of grief, because people have emotions and feelings and experiences in the workplace. And when we go through these transformations and we're expecting them to leave behind perhaps a process they created or a system they have used for 10 years and they've gotten very comfortable. And as humans, we like that. We like some level of predictability about what we do. And now we're saying that was great, but now we're bringing in a new system with new process and new tools and new ways of doing it. And so the communication, when we marry change leadership with change management, is all of that backstory of why we're making the change. How is it going to impact them? And how do we bring those people along with us, right? And then we get into the deeper elements of motivation and versus inspiring and how all of that works. And that is the key to transformation, right? And I think we've talked about how if you go into a room of 50 professionals and you ask everybody in the room to, you know, everybody here, raise your hand if you use some sort of technology. And everybody in the room at that point is going to raise their hand because everybody's using technology. And how many of you have a band-aid or a workaround for one of those technology tools you use? And likely everybody raises their hand, right? And that's a big indicator that change leadership likely did not happen. Yep. Because what happens is we layer in new technology over bad habits and bad process, and we didn't take into account emotions and habits. So people say, okay, I'll use your new tool, but I'm going to use the new tool in the same way I use the old tool. Yep. Right? So have you seen that in your experience in PMO, and how have you influenced people to make that change?
Yeah, and I've actually seen that quite a bit even when I go to conferences. I feel like every single conference around PMO, operational excellence, anything that isn't an HR conference that I go to, everyone's always like, yeah, I got the structure down pat, but I feel like there's something missing. My change management's not successful. Or if I do like a merger or acquisition, the people side of it's always missing somehow. And how do I bridge that gap? I feel like that's always the number one question. Like by theme, when I go to every conference is like change leadership 100%. So definitely hit the nail on the head there. But for me, the way I see it living and breathing is when you have your project team put together and you initially talk through that change leadership and what that looks like for that specific instance. So if it's a technology change, what does that look like from bringing in early adopters? So how can we look at those folks that may have a struggle with it because they are experts, they're SMEs on this technology? How do we get them to, and they enjoy that. So how do we get them to a place where they can be the SME on that new technology? And how can we bring them into the process earlier on? And then also having a plan for after that goes live. Because just because a technology goes live doesn't mean there's not some continuous improvement around it. And I think that's where that transparency really comes in too, of talking to your people that use that tool and say, hey, this isn't going to be perfect rolling out. Progress, not perfection, right? Like, right. As Barbie says, don't boil the ocean, which I hear a lot. So, but for me, it's okay, cool. We went live with it, but now what? Because, and how are we going to continue that adoption? Because just because you get good adoption up front doesn't mean that they're not going to find those things later on that they start to band-aid. And it's really understanding how you're going to plan for that, how you're going to plan for not having those band-aids, and empowering your employees to actually come forward with those ideas and suggestions, and having a process, going back to the change management piece, having a process to then help them continuously improve those pieces too. So there's a there's a lot of different tools you can use to infuse that change leadership, but those are some of the examples I've seen in my experiences.
And I love that you have that, the, you know, both sides of the coin, because that's really what it is, right? It's both sides of the transformation coin, the management, which is the structural elements, and then the leadership, which is the people, emotions, habits, and beliefs. And when you only focus on one, on either side, you'll likely never fully transform, because we can talk to folks about habits and behaviors, but if you don't have the right technology, it can be very frustrating, and they can lose faith that things will ever get better. And then you can go to the other side where you have great technology, but you have left the other pieces too far behind, and so you haven't helped your people get there. So when we look at that, and then we think about the folks who work within the HR or the people space, where have you seen the gap, I guess, now that you've been outside of HR and you have the opportunity to kind of look at it more objectively, right? I love this phrase that somebody shared with me a while ago. You can't read the label from inside the jar, right? And I was like, that's such a great way of thinking about it, because when you're in it and you really can't see it. So now that you've had some time outside of the jar and you're looking at it, like, what are some of the things you've identified or you have seen, whether it was within the organization you're working in today or just in general, because you've gone to these conferences and you've had experiences, if you could say, you know, if you could share with us what you see as maybe three gaps in the HR talent based on what you're hearing as the perception, right? Because that's the other thing that we have to think about. It's, we see ourselves a certain way, but how does the rest of the world see us? So maybe we start there. What has changed, or what has been your perspective change of HR from now being outside the jar? And then what are you seeing as gaps in the skill sets that we need our HR folks to have to carry us through, because we're going through this huge workplace transformation, partially because of COVID and partially because it's just time, right? We've got all of these other things. We have social unrest and all of these other things happening in the world, and we have to respond to those. So share with us kind of what you see there.
Yeah, it's definitely interesting. And looking back, even now that I'm not in HR, looking back on my prior experiences too, is just so funny to me, because in the moment, you know exactly what's happening in the HR space with your people, everything. And so you feel so in tune. And once I left, I'm like, oh, I don't feel as in tune as I was. What's happening? So it's definitely interesting. And one of the big gaps that I see is how people utilize their HR teams. And I know you and I talk personally a lot about the admin, the traditionalists, the HR traditional roles. I think now is a good time to start seeing that as a transformational space too, because a lot of the folks that I talk to at conferences or even in my past experiences, I look at how organizations are utilizing the HR function and space. And I feel like a lot falls on them, that from an admin perspective, but also from you're the people advocate perspective. And they're deemed, well, you're the people advocate. I, as a leader, don't necessarily need to have that because I have you, and you're supposed to be calling that out for me. So I think there's a lot of differences there. And for me, I think that's a good opportunity for our HR leaderships to hone in on their skill set of coaching, of influencing, and really understanding the business side of it, to be able to tie those two together. Because I think there's different conversations being had on the HR side. I feel like sometimes they speak a different language than the business side, and connecting those two together is just so key, because you don't realize what they're really looking for until like you're in it. So for me, when I've gone into this PMO strategy space, I've seen how people want it pitched, and I've seen how people want that executive summary of something to understand it a little bit. So I think that having that storytelling element as an HR leader is super important, to be able to tell that story of what you're trying to accomplish in your HR space. And I don't think that we necessarily have to stay in that HR lane anymore. Like, you don't have to stay in this tiny, tiny lane of like people advocacy and admin, and that's all you do. I think there's such an opportunity now when we talk about change management and the emotional side of it. I feel like a lot of HR people have that skill set so naturally. That's why they're drawn to the HR function to begin with. And how can they then leverage that skill set to help their people leaders? So for me, that's a huge gap that I've been seeing, is that connection between the language, that common language, and finding that common language and speaking and communicating in the business terms. And then also that storytelling element of how can you really tell that story of what the HR team really wants to drive and move forward with in tangent with the business, instead of more on a different level.
Yeah, I could not agree with you more, right? So hence the business of HR, right? And we've had this conversation, is when I launched this company, I knew that there was a big gap there between the language of business and the language of HR. And we need transformation to help people become business leaders who work in the people space versus people who, quote, work in HR. Because to your point, it is a different language, and we need our HR folks to speak that language if they want to be taken seriously, if they want to have that level of influence, to be able to work in partnership, right? It's collaborative. And we've got to be able to not only understand, but speak to them in a way that resonates and that they latch on to, so that they see that we are credible and we're able to do this. And we start to move away from being the, quote, you know, the event planners, the anniversary and the birthday people, to true strategists who work in concert with other business leaders. And we're there to help with the people strategy side of reaching their business goals. And that's really, I think, the approach that we're going to need going forward in all organizations, not just the big organizations where there's a very, you know, a large team and they have robust people programs. I think companies of any size really do need to understand that people strategy is what will move the needle. And it is the one common factor among every business in the globe, right? Any business that exists has people, whether it's a company of one or a company of a million, there are the common theme, no matter industry or product, is the people who work there, and helping those people grasp and understand what the business needs. And that's huge. So how have you seen effective HR leaders make that change and that transition to speaking the language of their business, and how has that worked?
Yeah, I think it's two part. I think it's being the true, coming to the table as the true expert in your space. So a lot of times I think people are like, oh, okay, I need to be a business leader, I need to know my business, and that's it. And that's not necessarily true either. You look at the HR space and how much is going on right now from the surveys around social responsibility, and how much employees want to see their employers speak up more about social responsibility. And then right now you have the whole like retention, I don't know if they're calling it retention apocalypse or whatnot, but they're foreseeing and forecasting a potential retention issue. And being able to be that HR leader that comes to the table and says, hey, I've been reading a lot about this in my space. This is a people trend that's happening. And we really need to get proactive with this before we do hit that retention wall where we're going to be starting to lose people after COVID starts dying down a little bit. And that's a huge thing that's coming up right now as a trend of how do we retain our employees? And that obviously we both know it drives back to culture, right? And being proactive about that, not reactive and trying to keep the ones that we want, right? So I think there's an element there, but being able to be that HR leader that just comes to the table with the information and informing what's going on in that people space, but then also advising, here's what I would recommend, and here's some solutions that we possibly have for that. Like, that makes you that triple threat, because even though you might know some of the business side, like you can shadow people, you can do those things to really understand and learn your business and learn the customers of your business. That's one element, but the more difficult element is actually taking your expertise in your area, bringing it to the table and having everyone understand the impact of that too. A lot of times we don't see HR specifically when it comes to like a KPI perspective. We only have retroactive KPIs. Like, we don't have in the moment like CSAT scores unless we're doing pulse surveys with people or something. But other than that, a lot of it really only comes out once people leave. So those types of things are what needs to get brought to the table on a regular basis and put in that business language for everyone to understand. So those are kind of the two elements I'm definitely seeing as successful HR people that come to the table and can speak their language, but then also translate it into someone else's.
Yeah, I think you hit on so many really important elements there with the one in that one response. The one thing that jumps out at me is the infrastructure, right? We have to have the infrastructure to be proactive. So as HR folks, if we're going to be agile and adaptable, and we're going to take agile mentality and apply it within the people space, that means that we have the tools and processes and systems or the infrastructure to operationalize much of what we're talking about right now. So how do you keep your thumb on the pulse of what's happening within your organization? Is it that you have, you know, frequent surveys? Is it that you have listening sessions? Is it, you know, are there those mechanisms within your organization where your people feel seen, valued, heard, and understood? Because it's one thing to ask them on an annual survey, which we all know at this point is really not very beneficial or impactful. If you're only going to survey your people once a year, I would challenge you to perhaps rethink that strategy. Because by the time you can implement something and survey them again, 25 other things have changed and impacted them and they're long past what they were responding to a year ago. So finding ways to have real time interaction and conversations and feedback is incredibly important. And to create an environment where people are encouraged and celebrated for being transparent with what they're thinking and feeling and experiencing. And you and I have experienced this in organizations, and I know many others have as well, where there's this underlying current of, you know, a fear culture and people are afraid to speak up. So we've got to make safe spaces for people to have the courage to share what their lived experience is without judgment, because we want them to be honest with us. We can't fix it if we don't know what it is. And for us to get that real information, we have to create that safe space for people to come forward and share without fear of retaliation or being told they are crazy or it's not them or it's them, it's not the leader or whatever the situation might be, right? So we as HR people, we have to think like a business leader to say, what is the infrastructure I need to create to enable real-time, transparent feedback coming in, not just going out, but coming in? Because I think oftentimes we focus on the going out, how we communicate out to our people, which is very important. But we have to round that out with how do we encourage our people to communicate with us so that we have that ongoing dialogue. And from there, you can build on top of that, right? And operationalize so many other areas of your values and your culture that you want. And to know what your culture is today. And we only know what our culture is today by asking the questions and identifying what those gaps are. And yep. And the other thing you said was that HR is often reactive. And I've had HR leaders, because I spend my days coaching HR leaders, ask me, how do I do that? How do I be that proactive person? Because to your point, all of our data is a look back. And I think that you become that proactive person by creating the infrastructure and the tools that keep your data real time and relevant. And then you have to take risks. You have to be willing to put yourself out there and make recommendations, knowing that not everybody's going to love those recommendations, but sometimes that's the hard work we have to do. And we have to have the courage to do that. So, you know, so many things there.
And that's sort of agile too, though, right? The whole fail fast mentality. Like if you're going to fail, you got to fail fast and then recover from it. That's the whole point of why people really like agile, not to fail, but to be able to do something fast and then learn from it and get better from it. And that's so key there. And when we talk about infrastructure and resources, for me, I see the gap of explaining why those are needed and why they're so important. I feel like when we look at an HR leader, one that's effective, they're able to explain that. And like we talked about, translate that of why those resources are so important, because sometimes they don't tie necessarily to a KPI. But people, as we all know, people experience is definitely tied to your bottom line. It's just harder to show it sometimes. And so I think that's also the struggle that some HR leaders have, is to really translate that over of, here's the infrastructure and the empowerment that we need to be able to be successful in our area. So that's, mm-hmm. that's definitely something that I've seen as a trend.
I agree. And with the agile mentality and the fail fast, it's important to remember, failure doesn't mean losing, just like winning doesn't mean success. Right. If you roll out a program in a perfect box with a bow because you've thought through each and every possible failure point and you've dressed it and it's this perfect program and you roll it out, it's likely already lost its shelf life if you've spent that much time, quote unquote, perfecting something. Yep. And our workplace, right, the whole VUCA mentality is so fast and so rapid that we simply can't spend 6 months or a year in the days past like we used to, right, planning a rollout for something. It's, let's try it with a small population. Let's pilot this. Let's iterate as we go and make the improvements we need. And I also think that that humanizes us. There's this strange, I guess, concept in the workplace, and we've experienced it, that for some reason, folks outside of HR tend to position, or in their minds position, HR folks as like, we don't make mistakes. There's no room for error. Because when an HR person rolls out a project or a program or an initiative, it could impact people's paychecks if it's not accurate. It could impact their benefits. It could impact very personal things. So there is an underlying fear within HR even of failure, because our impact is so personal. And I think we've got to find ways to get through that fear and say, we still have to try. And I think if we try on smaller scales and then grow the influence throughout the organization, that is the best way going forward to roll things out or to gain that trust. Are you seeing that within your experiences over the past, say, 6 months?
Yeah, I definitely see the way that I see people outside of HR think about HR and look at HR is, it's definitely like, here are the people that enforce policy. Here are the people that are those decision makers from a policy perspective, or from like employee relations, like the whole HR, don't tell HR jokes and everything, right? Like, or like, oops, I just clicked on a call. Like, don't tell HR I did that. And I think that still being a joke is also something that's really hindering the HR function. And I've seen that everywhere in my career, right? It's always like, oh, you're in HR, so I'm not gonna say anything. And I look at them like, say what you want. Like, I'm transparent too, I'm human too. Like, what do you think I'm I feel like they consider HR the policing station, right? And that makes us not have that humanization element to us, because we don't, they don't see us as that, as someone that can make mistakes or someone that is a project manager or a leader because of the whole policing thing. So it's simple things like that within your culture that if someone makes a joke like that, you know it's an issue, because they clearly, that's their perception of HR, and perception is reality. And the more and more they joke about that, other people are going to start joking about that. And it really spreads very quickly. So it's really understanding where people's perceptions are at in your current state culture of the HR function, and then changing that first, or else you're never going to be able to get anything done if you can't change your own perception of your own department. So,
yeah. And it takes courage to do that, because to do that, you have to go out and solicit honest feedback about what people think about you as an HR professional and of your team and of the work you do, and hope that you'll receive that trust and transparency back, which leads us to trust in the relationships we have, and also asking the tough questions, right? If you don't see people and that they trust you as an individual, getting underneath that and finding out why is hard, right? Yep. Sometimes it's hard looks in the mirror, and what have I done to create that or to inspire that perception of me? And, you know, we've all heard it. Oh, can't say that. HR's in the room. Nobody can say a cuss word because HR's in the room. And I'm like, really? When did that become my job? Right.
And then you're like, oh, am I not supposed to curse then? Like, exactly. I'm just going to drop a curse word in the next like minute just to prove my point. Right. And exactly. I think it's taking your own personality too, because you can get all the feedback you want, but at the end of the day, you still have to be the HR leader. That's you. And you're bringing your whole self with yourself too. And I think that's important too, because for me, I'm going to respond a lot differently than someone else when someone makes an HR joke about like, ooh, HR's in the room, I can't curse, or HR, blah, blah, blah. Like, I'm going to directly be like, oh, really? Like, why do you think that? Like, what made you really feel like that about HR? Or like I said, I'll probably drop a curse word in the next minute just to prove my point that I can curse too. So it really just depends on your personality. I'm more direct with my approach as opposed to some people building their relationships. They're way different than that. So I think it's important that HR is also not just one person, one personality. HR is very diverse already as it is. So bringing your diversity of thought to the table and your own personality, your own values to what you want your HR organization to look like going forward.
So yes, and I swear we did not rehearse this, but that was such a perfect segue to the next thing I wanted to talk about was... I love it. I love it when a plan comes together. So with the work I do now, coaching HR professionals, consulting, kind of that adjunct CHRO consulting for people strategy, a lot of the work that I do with my clients is helping HR or people teams craft their own mission and purpose statements, craft their own values, because we have our company mission, we have our company values, and those are incredibly important. We need to be aligned with that. But within our own function, we should have clarity, crystal clarity on what we believe our purpose is within that organization. And creating those purpose statements and identifying our values, it creates our true north, right? It's what it's our litmus test. So when our stakeholders come to us, or our internal leaders or people come to us and say, we want to do this, or we want to change this, or this doesn't work for me, we can run it through that and say, okay, does that align with the purpose of the HR or the people function? And if it doesn't, then we need to potentially either revisit to say, have we comprehensively thought about our purpose? And or is it really work that doesn't belong within HR, but it gets thrown over the fence as the catch-all, right? And I can think of one example in a former organization where the HR team was responsible for ordering steel-toed boots and safety glasses for employees in the distribution and manufacturing space. And I'm like, why are we doing this? That's a safety issue or an operations issue. And the answer was, well, nobody else had time or knew how to do it, so HR took it on. And I'm like, no, That's not an HR function. That is an administrative function that either the safety team needs to own because they have specific criteria around whatever steel-toed boots and safety goggles they want. And if there aren't specific criteria, then that's equipment and PPE that the operations team needs to order and distribute to their people. There's no reason for HR to be involved in that whatsoever. And that's a very simplistic example. But if anybody who's watching or listening right now steps back and thinks about all of these disparate things that over time you've just picked up because you're HR, and critically look at those, how much of the work you're doing every day or the work your team is doing every day is meaningful people strategy and people support versus this stuff that we've just taken on, right? So by having that purpose statement and those values, you're able to decide, does this fit or doesn't this fit, and then move on from there. And I feel like that's what a lot of teams don't do that work. They just accept it because, okay, well, that's what we do. We're the people pleasers, right? And so somebody asks us to do something and we do it, and then all of a sudden we own it and it becomes ours to fix into perpetuity. And that's not necessarily the best way to create a people strategy infrastructure. So I love that you said that, and that whole values piece is incredibly important because you have your company values, you have the values of your HR team, but then you have your personal values, right? And you know, we've been through exercises where we've identified our top two values, and what you said really resonates with me. My top two values are authenticity and wholeheartedness. So I know, right, that I can only be me. And to your point, it's you figure out what your values are and then you bring that into the conversation. I only know how to be who I am authentically. And I don't speak jargon and I don't overstate things and that type. Like, I just, it's just me, right? And if you see me on the street corner, walking my dog, you see me in the mall or you see me in the office, it's always just going to be the same person. But I think a lot of HR people aren't that. And not because they're trying to be misleading, but they feel like when they have their HR hat on, they have to be these very rigid, church ladies, right? Yeah. Like you said, police. Yeah. And
you said people pleaser, right? So if you're a people pleaser, you literally are not living into your values. Like, that's the complete opposite. If you're trying to please other people, you're not living in your values probably most of the time. So it's interesting that you mentioned that piece, because I'm like, yep, that's part of not living your value. And eventually you'll feel that, whether it be you're physically or mentally, you'll start feeling it if you start down that path. And I think it's interesting that you mentioned the HR function doing things that aren't the HR people strategy piece. Because if you look at it from a business side of it, like we talk about business translation, the easiest way I would describe that to leaders would be, so your sales function, let's talk about your sales function. If what percentage of them are actually helping customers and doing customer service work versus actually selling? Because if someone's looking at the top line, they're looking at, if salespeople aren't selling, it is a red flag. It's the end of the world. So, but at the same point, if HR people aren't doing people strategy, like that's sometimes the thought process, right? It's like, well, does that really make an impact? Or salespeople not selling, why is that such a big red flag as opposed to people leaders not doing people strategy? So I think that's a good way to frame that sometimes with those conversations and starting that tough dialogue is, well, if your salespeople aren't selling and your people strategy people aren't strategizing around people and what should be moving forward internally with the people experience, those are really essentially the same thing. But one you can see more from a KPI perspective and one you can't. So, but does that make it a really big difference? Not necessarily.
Right. But it's hard. It's harder. Yeah. Right. Yeah. And I think that's why we haven't had a lot of CEOs and, you know, COOs and CFOs really embrace the people strategy piece, because frankly, it's difficult. It's not black and white. I've done many panels and webinars in the past few years, and I say this all the time. There is no silver bullet for people strategy. It is not black and white. And we often have leaders who want things to be clean and black and white and predictable. And while there is some predictability, the work of people is, it's an art and a science. And we need people who understand both of those elements to lead people's strategy, which brings us to, I think, kind of the last element of the conversation. And again, we didn't plan this, guys, but I'm loving how this is working. If there were, you know, if there were two things that you could advise HR people today, Casey, now that you've had this experience of being in HR, being outside of HR, and now that you're going back in, if there were two things that would be important for HR people to know, either about the perception of HR or skill sets that are needed that we're not seeing, what would that be?
Oh boy, making me pick two things. Well, I give you my laundry list of things that I'm bringing back.
Say more than two. I just didn't want to overwhelm you, but yeah, you have more
than two. It's overwhelming selecting a tiny list. I really think going back to when we talk about transforming their own space first, I think is really important, because we tend to focus so little on our own house and we focus on other people's, because that tends to be the personality type that's drawn to the HR spaces, helping others. And so you tend to not focus on yourself. That's like when you're a mother or something like that, where you don't actually have some self-care time, right? Is because you're so focused on other people. So for me, it's also going through and looking at your own house, looking at your HR function as a whole, looking at your infrastructure, looking at the way that your team interacts with people and the relationships that they have today. I think those things, and understanding your current state of your current house, as I call it, your HR function as a whole, how you're navigating the space today, and then being able to understand that perception of, that people have on you too, because you could think that you're the greatest HR leader ever, and they could think that too. Who knows until you ask the question. So for me, it's looking at your house internally. And then the secondary thing I would say is understanding the perceptions that happen. I think we're all very much aware by now of the HR perceptions, the stereotypical, like that meme that's like, here's what I think I do. Here's what my parents think I do. Here's what my boss thinks I do. That whole meme, like I feel like every HR person lives that on a regular basis. So I think that perception is pretty well known, but I feel like going out and actually seeking that feedback of the perceptions of you and your value to the others is really important too. And understanding your specific value and your team's specific value, because then that way you'll understand how to get into a space that you want to get into. But really understanding that current state is so key for having that initial structure and that initial conversation.
Yeah, I agree with you. I would also add to that, because sometimes asking doesn't really get us the information we need. Because if I were to say right now, if I were to ask you, Casey, to give me direct feedback, you likely would, because we trust one another, right? We have that history, that relationship. I know that any feedback you give me, you would be coming out of a place of wanting me to improve. And it wouldn't be critical just for being hurtful. However, not everybody has that kind of a relationship. And so sometimes when you go to your stakeholders and you ask for feedback, they're like, oh, it's great. You're great. Everything's fine. That in and of itself is the very first indicator that they don't trust you. And yeah. So if you are an HR person and you're sitting there saying to yourself, well, I ask my stakeholders all the time how I'm doing and how the team is doing, and they don't tell me anything other than it's fine, you're doing a great job. That is the very first sign that they do not trust you, because no one is perfect. There's always room to improve. So if you're not steadily getting constructive, meaningful feedback on ways in which things could be different, better, or changed, that's a sign that your internal stakeholders don't trust you. Because I've had people say that to me before. Well, I've asked and everybody seems happy, so I must be doing everything right. And I'm like, but are you? Probably not, because none of us do. I know I am far, far from perfect. So the first thing is to critically look at what is available to you, right? If you've asked and you're not getting feedback, then what are some of the other indicators, right, that could be telling you whether or not your people trust you? Are you being brought in before a decision is made, or are you simply being informed of a decision? Yeah. Right. That's another indicator that your input and your value is not seen and placed where it should be, because you're not being brought in prior to a decision. If people avoid having conversations with you, and when they do, everything's perfect, big sign. So I think that's another way that HR folks can critically look at how they're perceived in their organizations and find those one or two trusted partners to start giving you real feedback, and then you can start to build trust among your other stakeholders, because it's incredibly important. And you said something else that I think was really important, is that self-care is not selfish. Yep. Knowing who you are and your values and what you're willing to compromise and not compromise will make or break your ability to have a sustained and meaningful career. Because I think you said it a little bit differently, but if you're constantly in a position to compromise your personal values simply because it's what your CEO or your COO or your CFO is telling you to do, that's not sustainable. And you will either burn out, or you will be deemed unsuccessful because you are not living fully into who you are. And I've seen so many HR folks try to mask who they really are authentically to be liked or to fit in. And it's just simply, people won't respect you for it, and there's no value in it. So figure out what your values are. And then, as you said, live and lean into those and bring that into your conversations.
Yep. And it sounds like you just made some more material there with your whole indicator checklist. So
I know, right? So
hey, we're about to roll out after this.
I love it. Well, Casey, thank you so much. We are at the top of the hour. I know we got started late. I thank everyone for their patience. Technology and I don't always get along, and typically I have someone in the background managing things for me, but I tried to do it all myself. Clearly I have some lessons to learn. But I'm excited. This is the kickoff session for our Thought Leader Roundtables. The next session is coming up on June 8th, which I believe is a Tuesday at noon, where I am moderating a conversation much like this, but we have three CHROs, or Chief People Officers, who are going to tell us what they see and what they see as strengths and gaps in talent as they're interviewing new talent for their teams, or they're out in the world delivering keynotes or interacting with stakeholders. And so I'm really excited to hear from them, because a lot of the folks who follow me on LinkedIn and YouTube in different areas, they want to grow their careers. They want to become that executive level HR person, whether it's chief people officer, chief HR officer, chief administrative officer, whatever your organization calls it, but they just don't know how to get there. And so this Thought Leader series is created with the intention of helping our people and HR practitioners learn how to level up. And, you know, the five imperatives are a part of it. That's the how we do the work we do, because we focus on the what, right? We focus on the results of the work we do. As you said, it's the look back, but how is the most important element. And I think our businesses and society is starting to realize that now, right? This is no longer a Machiavellian world. The how is as important as the what, and the how is what we often neglect. And we've got to do a much better job. So I'm really excited for the session on Tuesday. The session after that, I will be interviewing marketing folks and the intersection of HR and marketing, finance people. So it's going to be an exciting time. So thank you everybody for being here today. You can find me on LinkedIn. You can find me at barbiewinterbottom.com or businessofhr.com. Casey, thank you so much for your contribution today. So excited about your new journey. You'll be back with us as often as possible. So I'm super excited. Love watching your career. You're amazing. And thank you everybody for joining us. We will see you again next week. Thanks a lot. Bye. Bye-bye.